So the low political participation of women, the fact that we have very few women in parliament, may reflect both taste discrimination or social or statistical discrimination, this idea that women are less competent, or both. When you do experiments where you ask people to look at a vignette where someone is shown a leadership situation, so-and-so is a leader and they did this and they did that, what do you think? Do you think they acted well? If you change just the gender of the leader, people think that men are better leaders than women. Actually, both men and women think that men are better leaders than women, even though the description of the situation is exactly the same. With Laurie Beeman, Rohini Pandey, Petya Tobalova, and Raghad Chattopadhyay, I did some research in West Bengal. And in West Bengal, like everywhere in India, there is political reservation, so there are women and men leaders. So people are in principle somewhat used to at least the idea. So what we did is we took a speech that was given by some leader, modified it a little bit, and then had a range of female actors and male actors read the speech on tapes. And then we went to the village and we asked people to listen to the speech. And as they listened to the speech, after they listened to the speech, we asked them a bunch of questions about the speech. What do you think this leader was competent? Would you vote for them? Did they address the question, etc.? And women and respondents that were given the female speech thought that the speech was much worse than the male speech. And one possible explanation, we didn't ask them anything about whether they would like to have a female as leader, we just asked them to read the speech, so it was pure competence. One possible explanation for that is that, in general, people are also biased, they don't want to have women leader, therefore they have not seen very many, although in India there are very many at the top, there are not very many in the village politics. And therefore, women are unknown quantities. You don't know, you know, maybe you might think that they are worse on average, but at best, you will think that there is a higher variance, there are risky propositions. So when you hear a speech, you're saying, well, I don't know, it doesn't look too good to me. And in that case, even if for some reasons the taste discrimination was going to go away, the statistical discrimination, the idea that women are less competent would still be there, so that women wouldn't be elected. So it's not going to go away on its own. That implies that some biases will probably not disappear on their own. Some policies targeting women will continue to be needed. And what's important to acknowledge, which is not always acknowledged in policy circles, is that if you do policies in favor of women, this will come at the expense of men or boys. This is not free. When you redistribute from men to women, this will come at the expense of men. So in the case of political quotas, that's obvious. Any seat that the woman takes is a seat that the man doesn't take. In the case of policies, for example, that favor girls in education, people are usually trying to sweep this under the carpet, but it's also the case. Consider, for example, giving scholarships for girls, which is a very popular policy in a lot of developing world to encourage girls to go to school. So it's there in Bangladesh, for example. These kind of policies are actually very expensive per extra girl you bring to school because there are already a lot of girls in school. But you have to give them the scholarship anyway, even though they would have gone to school without your scholarship. So you end up paying, I'm sorry for the jargon, a lot of inframarginal people. They would have gone to school anyway, but you need to give them a scholarship, which means that per extra girl in school, this ends up being an extremely expensive policy. So you could have done something that was gender blind, like having more teachers, for example, or treating children for their warmth, or making sure they're healthy in other dimensions, which would actually help men and women equally, so wouldn't bridge a gap, but would end up being much cheaper per extra years of education. So there is a real trade-off, and it's good to have it in mind. That doesn't mean we don't want to do it, but it comes as a trade-off. So because there is a trade-off, there is a reason to justify gender-based policies. So you really have two reasons why you might justify gender-based policy. One way is you can say it's a matter of equity. So here's Kofi Annan from the UN. The full participation for women to all levels of decision-making is a human right. So that's totally fine. I would agree with this proposition. People might not agree. Collectively, we might arrive at some decision. But it's a decision of It's a reason we value equity between men and women for its own sake. We think it's not right that girls are less likely to make it than boys. There is another possible argument, though, which is an efficiency argument, which is that even if it's costly for boys in the short run, in the long run, empowering women will make everyone better off. So maybe not today's men, but maybe future men, so that in some idea of a long run, which is usually left relatively vague, there is no trade-off, actually, that equity and efficiency will go together. This position, this latter position, that empowerment is desirable for efficiency as well as for equity, shapes the policy debate and policies the world over, from microcredit, which is given almost exclusively to women, to conditional cash transfer, which again are given almost exclusively to women. So what I want to do now is to see whether there is some reason to think that there is indeed this relationship between the power of women, their education, their income, their access to political power, property rights, and things like that, and let's say, to employ a technical term, good things, education, health, productivity in the house, etc. Before that, I'll cite this quote because that's pretty emblematic of what people have in mind. Education for girls has a catalytic effect on every dimension of development, lower child and maternal mortality rates, increased educational attainment by daughters and sons, higher productivity, improved environmental management. Together, this can mean faster economic growth and, equally important, wider distribution of the fruits of growth. More education for girls will also enable more and more women to attain leadership positions at all levels of society, from health clinics to the village to parliaments in the capitals. This in turn will change the way societies will deal with problems and raise with the quality of global decision making. So this is, in a nutshell, this is actually beautifully concise, a way of putting this idea of this virtuous circle, which in this case starts with education, and everything will follow. You'll have more productivity, more growth, and therefore also more education again. So let's look at reasons to think that indeed there is a lot of truth to this idea that empowerment of women might lead the decision to change and possibly the decision to change in a good way or in a long-term, in a way that's favorable to long-term development. So let's step back a little bit and think about why would that be the case anyway? Because after all, most women are married to men, or at least the ones who have children. So we're thinking, for example, about if I manage to empower women, either by giving them more education or by improving their incomes, will I improve investment in kids? So in an ideal family, that shouldn't really matter. Who holds the balance of power within the household is irrelevant. They should make their decisions together, and the fact that someone has a little more power or a little less power within the house shouldn't make a difference. Well, anybody who lives in a family knows that families are not ideal in this sense anyway, and that in fact there is some relationship between people bargaining positions and what the decisions that are being made on a day-to-day basis. But it took some economists some time to get at it. So the first very nice papers on that are from Duncan Thomas in the 1990s, which shows that there is in fact a strong relationship between the share of income that is being owned by women, or that women have the property of, and the ways the budget are spent. So in particular, there's more investment in nutrition, more investment in education, more investment in health when women have a higher share of the income. However, this may not indicate a causal effect, because nicer husbands, the one who like their children, might also be happy to have their woman go out to work. So they might be, in general, more open-minded people, and that's why we see the two things go together. And if we forced the not-so-nice husband to give some power to their woman, they wouldn't change the way they invest in their children.